Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the July 20th, 2016 board meeting of DRCOG. I will apologize in advance if I have vacation head. It's been full 6 weeks since I've seen you all. Sorry to miss the work session, but I hope everybody's having a great summer. And let me bring the meeting to order, and we'll start off with the Pledge of Allegiance. And Connie, if you'll call the roll.
Okay. Eva Henry, Jan Pulowski, Bill Holen, Nancy Sharp, Elise Jones,
here.
David Beacom,
here.
Tim Mock, Chrissy Fanganello,
here.
Robin Kneach, Kevin Flynn, Roger Partridge,
here.
Gail Watson, Don Rozier, Libby Szabo, Bob Pfeiffer,
here.
Bob Roth, Renee Peterson, Larry Vidim,
here.
David Spellman, Aaron Brockett,
here.
Ann Justin,
here.
Lynn Baca,
here.
George Teal, Paul Donahue, Doris Trular, Carrie Penaloza, Ron Engels, Catherine Hyder, Laura Chrisman,
here.
Richard Champion,
here.
Rick Teeter,
here.
Debbie Nasta, Carl Randolph, Steve Conklin,
here.
Joe Jefferson, Jeff Deacon,
here.
Daniel Dick,
here.
Lisa Jones, Laura Brown, Lynette Kelsey,
here.
Scott Norquist,
here.
Saoirse Karras Graves,
here.
Ron Rakowski,
present.
Mike Hillman, Brad Weasley, Stephanie Walton, Shakti,
here.
Jerry Bean, Phil Cernanek,
present.
Jackie Millay, Wynn Shaw,
here.
Joan Peck,
here.
Ashley Stolzman,
here.
Connie Sullivan,
here.
Colleen Whitlow,
here.
Deborah Jerome, Sean Foray, Chris Larson, Kyle Mullica,
here.
John Dyack,
here.
Sally Daigle,
here.
Rita Dozal,
here.
Adam Metkowski, Eric Montoya, Herb Atchison,
here.
Joyce J,
here.
Gary Sanford, Deborah Perkins Smith,
here.
Bill Van Meter,
here.
And we have a quorum.
Wonderful. Thank you, Connie. And now I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda if we're so inclined.
So moved.
You have a motion, a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
So moving on to my report, I have to start with some official business, which is setting a public hearing on regional air quality conformity. So let me read the official statement. The Denver Regional Council of Governments, DRCOG, hereby schedules a public hearing to receive comments on the redetermination of air quality conformity for the 2015 Cycle 2 2040 Fiscally Constrained Regional Transportation Plan and the amended 2016-2021 Transportation Improvement Program. The hearing will be held before the Board of Directors at 6:30 p.m. at the DRCOG offices on August 17, 2016. For further information, please contact the Executive Office at DRCOG at 303-455-1000 or write to DRCOG, 1290 Broadway, Suite 100, Denver, Colorado, 80203. Let it be so. I noticed that I forgot to introduce new members and alternates, and I believe we have two new alternates, but neither one of them are in attendance tonight, but we'll announce them anyway. Jan Pulowski is the alternate now from Adams County, and from Superior we'll have Sandy Pennington. So we will welcome them in person when they attend. And I guess the only other announcement I want to make is we have coming up in the next 2 weeks a very important event, and that is the annual DRCOG board retreat. And we have 25 people signed up, which is less than half. And that's kind of a disappointing number. This is a really important meeting gathering to come to, and I think others can attest that it's important for a couple different reasons. I would say top of my list is the relationship building. You get to spend some quality time with your fellow board members and get to know them, In addition to learning more about Dr. Cog, there will be adult beverages where we sit around and enjoy each other's company and learn a little more about each other. And for those of us who've been here for a while, we understand that relationships are really what helps regionalism, and the retreat is a really good place to form them. And then there's the Performance and Engagement Committee has really put together an exciting agenda for us. And so I really strongly encourage you, if you haven't already signed up, please do so. Unfortunately, at this late date, you won't get the cheap rate at the hotel, but come anyway. And if you are able to come and you haven't signed up yet, you'll need to let Connie know so she can make it all work for us. So again, hope to see you all there, and it'll be a good time. And I think that's all I have. So I will turn it over to Jennifer.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to point out that the purple flyer at your seat, that is about the workshop. So if you don't have all the details, they're all right here. And as the chair mentioned, you can let Connie or Doug Rex know if you're interested in attending, but you haven't gotten registered yet. I want to call your attention to the blue flyer as well at your seat. This is related to the electric vehicle workshop that we've been talking about. This is going to take place on August 16th. It'll be here at Dr. Cog from 1 to 4. There will be just a general update about EVs in Colorado, as well as some information on workplace charging, building codes, fleets. And I think what a lot of people are interested in is group purchasing. You can contact Doug Rex if you'd like some additional information about that as well. Let's see. Let me turn the page here. Later on this evening, let me see what number it is. Agenda item 14. Depending on how that goes tonight, if it goes well and we're able to continue moving forward, we'll be canceling the August work session. So a little incentive to get through that this evening. The other thing that I want to point out is in your agenda package, and that's the report from the executive director. That's under attachment A. There are two reports in there, one for the month of May. That's in there because you didn't have a June meeting when you would normally get that. But the one that I really want to call your attention to is the one for June. And it's kind of fat. And the reason it's fat, as you'll recall, I've been telling you that this is really under construction and has been for quite some time. But the executive office, led by Jerry Stiegel, our director of organizational development, we finally put together all the finishing touches. I think there's just a couple of very minor things that are still in here that we haven't quite finished up. But for the most part, the balance scorecard for the executive office has been completed. And this is kind of a report of all of those measures that are in there. And I've asked Jerry to speak to the report tonight just to kind of get everyone familiar with what's in here, what these things mean. Some of the data points that we're using for measures are single data points. Others are a couple or three data points smooshed together to come up with the measurements. So Jerry will kind of walk you through that. I also want to let you know that we are going to, because performance and engagement now is focused largely on the performance of the executive director and how well the executive director implements your work plan, et cetera. We'll start putting this in their agendas from here on out, and I'll just be giving a much more simple report like I've done in the past. So they'll be looking at all the detail while the board is hearing kind of the highlights. And if ever you want that information, we'll be sure and get it to you. So with that, I'll just turn it over to Jerry and ask him to kind of walk you through some of the newer stuff that's in the report this month.
All right, thank you. Good evening. Just a couple of things. What I will share with you and just verbalize is in the back of all the monthly reports in terms of the report explanation. But there's a couple of things I want to point out that, as Jennifer mentioned, as we start building or designing our measures and we get measure data, we will start bringing back to you the framework that those of you who have seen the MetroVision strategy framework, it will be identical to that, minus outcomes. But we've developed those. We'll have objectives, measures, targets, and some references to initiatives and or tasks that are ongoing that will drive that particular objective. There will be a new score that will show up, and it's in the explanation in the back of that report, but it'll be a quick score rating on objectives, and it will be 0 to 10. I'm not going to get into a lot of detail on it for you unless you have questions, but what quick score does, it allows us to kind of level set a way of looking at each component by scoring it at 0 to 10 in addition to the measure value score. So if we set targets for our measures, we're going to also see that how that's going. And so we've done that, but I think the underscore here is that that framework will be identical to the MetroVision framework. And I think that's really important that we have one version of the truth on this, okay? I mentioned the new score. Here's the next step. It's always to chase measure data. So once you get the scorecard design, you've got the heavy lifting done, but chasing the measure data is the next thing. So we'll be gathering the data, and eventually you'll start to see more of it come in. But obviously it won't occur overnight. Just take some time. You may have new measures you've never collected data before on those particular ones. So I'll stop and ask what questions you might have.
Any questions for Jerry?
Certainly. Like a bar chart or a line graph?
Oh, I'm sorry. when there's numerical data on top of a colored box, The numbers are hard to read on blue and green. Other colors come through better, I don't know if anybody else has had that trouble, but it's like, okay, how can I turn this page to get the number?
You know, I won't take time now, but I'd love to see that if we have a chance this evening and just see what it looks like compared to what ours is, and maybe I'll know. But I always kind of take a look at that to see that it's clear. But as Jennifer indicated, it's a pretty lofty report, so I could miss something. I can tell you that.
Sure.
All right.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thanks, Jerry.
Thank you.
Anything else?
That concludes my report.
All right. So we'll move on to public comment, which is the opportunity for members of the audience to come speak to us for up to 3 minutes on any items for which a prior public hearing has not been held before the board. Do we have any takers? We do.
My name is Randall Loeb. I'm a citizen here in Denver, and I work with people in extreme poverty. It's been a long time, so I'm kind of rattled to be seeing all these new faces. What I want to talk about is what was just done in Denver. The city passed a proposal. It has to go before city council, but it's worked out between city council and the mayor to create affordable housing and a permanent housing fund, which will then generate the revenue we need in order to create the housing necessary to make sure that people are not on the streets, which you probably have noticed has increased. And we need to have, and it says in the reports, and I've been reading all of them, that you have 50% of creation of housing of a wide berth. And believe me, that is got to be including shelters, because a lot of people are at such a low level of functioning that they can't live anywhere else. And it was pointed out to me, although it was an accident, that permanent supportive housing is an issue for some people. And actually, permanent supportive housing is not a dole out to make sure that people essentially can live off of the government for the rest of their life. It's a matter of making sure that people have an opportunity to increase their revenue and tax base and then give to people. So what we need, and I urge you to think about this, is a regional affordable housing plan that includes all the counties that represent this, and it will then help us to have permanent funding to create this housing, and the supportive services are absolutely necessary. I live in a building that I manage with ex-felons of very serious nature. And without this kind of support, we're basically throwing people under the bus. Thank you for your time. I sometime would love to make a full-blown presentation to you, but this is what we'll have to do at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lowe. Any other takers? Seeing none, then we'll close the public comment period and move on to our strategic informational briefings. And we have the great opportunity to hear an update on the Mobility Choice Blueprint. And Doug, are you queuing this up before?
I am.
Oh, you are. All right.
Well, I just.
You're not.
No, I'm not done.
But are you queuing?
Oh, I am.
You're queuing it up. And wow. He's done. Well, there
we go. I hope the presentation goes better.
He's a very efficient presenter.
Right, indeed.
I didn't hear what it was.
That's about right. Well, Madam Chair, thank you very much. Good evening to everybody. I just wanted to give you a quick update on where we are with this and kick it off for our two presenters this evening. The board may recall back in December, Don Hunt, former director of CDOT, gave a presentation, a briefing to the board about a new initiative called Mobility Choice. And the premise of this initiative is to maximize investments in transportation by leveraging future technology. So in other words, we know innovations in transportation are coming fast and furious. So, you know, really, so what are we going to do as a region to prepare ourselves for that inevitable future? You know, how should we be investing our funding in order to prepare ourselves for that? So so DRCOG staff has been meeting with staffs of RTD, CDOT, and the chamber to begin to flush out some of the details of what this initiative might be. And ultimately, you know, we've kind of coalesced around this concept of developing a mobility choice blueprint, which is kind of a plan for this initiative. And we're far enough along now that we thought it was important to come to you tonight to give you a briefing about where we are and really ask you if this is, you know, a direction you want to go and provide some investment in order for us to do that. This is really, there's nothing like this in the country. This is you know, kind of, you know, groundbreaking stuff in a lot of respects, and there'll be, you know, little growing pains, I'm sure, as we go along. But we're excited about the opportunity. There are some things we want you to be sure and be frank about, you know, with regards to where we're headed with this. But with that said, what we have for you today, we have Kelly Bruffs here, who's president and CEO of the Denver Metro Chamber. And we also have Don is here as well, and he's going to give an actual PowerPoint presentation. But Kelly just wanted to speak first to give the chamber's perspective on this.
Thank you so much. And what a great introduction. You know, I think when I stand before you, I think all of you are probably thinking, why would a Chamber of Commerce care and start to partner with all public entities to address transportation or mobility in the region? We talked to you last December about why we're doing it. And last December, I think our focus for the last couple of years has been around this notion that in our country, we've always turned to the public sector and said to you, figure out what the investments are and please make them. And the truth is, we can't do that anymore, that both the pace of change and the need for change can't rely solely on the public sector. And so we have member businesses who have come together to say, we should partner. Our greatest successes in Colorado have always been built out of partnerships, and this is another one where planning together we can be smarter and better. And not just with one government entity, but across multiple jurisdictions, where we work with DRCOG, CDOT, and RTD, which, by the way, we have learned doesn't appear to be happening anywhere in the country, where entities from different government levels are really coming together to say, what are the right investments that each of us make that maximize what we're trying to accomplish? And then the public sector as well. And in December, we shared with you our vision, and I'm excited for Don to share with you where we're at today. I would never have predicted in 6 months the private sector has come forward with an energy and a vitality around our commitment. You'll see it both in our financial commitment to this effort, meeting and matching our public sector partners, but you'll also see it in the energy and commitment that people are putting up staff to partner as we think about how we plan together. And so I thank you for giving us time to share with you and together figure out how we might do this. to accomplish more for our citizens in Colorado and continue to have the greatest economy in the country. So I'll turn it to Don to give you the details, and you can ask him the hard questions.
Don't you go anywhere, Kelly. Great to be back, see so many familiar faces and a few new ones. Really looking forward to getting to know all of you. So Mobility Choice Blueprint, this was, you know, I just didn't get enough working with agencies and cities and counties in my 4 years at CDOT. And this is all about really looking at the future, trying to get a hold of the future enough so that we continue to have economic prosperity and quality of life in the Denver region around the new mobility. And Doug's going to do the slides for me. So why now? Number one, and Bill Van Meter is here. Bill's been a great partner helping to put this together. This is what is happening in 1 year with the whole rollout of fast tracks. And the Westminster B line by the end of this month. So another one will get colored up blue, and that raises the whole question. We've done fast tracks. We have a wonderful light rail and commuter rail system. How do we really make it successful? What's our post strategy as we've rolled out these new rail lines? Next slide. Another reason why, this is two things I really discovered at CDOT. We'd really lost a lot of the private sector participation in the transportation and mobility planning process, and I'd go over to the chamber, Kelly will vouch for me, and say, you know, we really need to renew that kind of business participation. It's very helpful, can really do a much better job. And I said, if I am able to retire successfully from CDOT, that's one of the things I'm going to work on. And here I am, really trying to bring large private employers and private companies into this process in a more permanent way. And then another objective, it's three agencies, I think, that work better than ever before, all together. I think the communication is very good. But I would say that at a strategic level, looking into the future as we have new challenges in this metro area with growth and changing technology, we need to up our game a little bit in terms of working together. And then finally, I think this is what really grabs people's imagination. We read about it in the newspaper, and we hear about how, you know, there are going to be connected vehicles, automated vehicles. We see Uber and Lyft and other new private services. The whole kind of blurring of public transit and private transportation is going on right before our eyes right now. And are we really ready for that? So it's this technology that is coming whether we want it to or not, that it really says we need to get ready with how we look at our public investments over the next, and probably about 15 years as change will occur. So the Mobility Choice is both an organization and a document, a product. I'm going to be the convening executive director. We'll be hiring a more permanent executive director in a couple of months. Our board met for the first time. You can see that we have a pretty good list of private sector individuals who represent large employers, as well as some of the technology companies that are working in the new mobility, like Panasonic, Aero Electronics, IHS, and then members from the public sector. We're looking at the lead person, the general manager or executive director of the three major agencies, Jennifer and Dave Genova and Shailen Batt, or maybe Mike Lewis, they're making that decision at CDOT, will be on the board, as well as two people I think you know. We wanted to have locally elected officials who are retired, and so they could represent the entire region at large, and we chose Will Tuer and Jack Hilbert, not because of their political similarities, because there are a few, but their ability to work together and I think represent a pretty wide range of opinion about government and its role in mobility, two people who are going to be great on that board. We have one more person to add from Kaiser Permanente. So that's the organization. Go to the blueprint. What we are trying to do, and this is always the tough part, and I've had to go around the state with my little tin cup and say, we can do this if only you'll make a contribution here locally. Well, that's what I'm doing again. But the unique part here is we have the private sector, the chamber coming to the table with a $500,000, we're asking for each of the three agencies, each of the three agencies, to also contribute $500,000. It would develop a strategic direction for Denver mobility investment over the next 15 years. That's the technological change period. And we want to do this with a consulting team. We've already been working with all of the best firms in the Denver region as well as around the country. We think we can put this blueprint together in the next 18 months, and it has to include a very important public engagement effort. What we're talking about here with changing mobility, it's one thing to ask people about what they want. We're in the unique position of asking folks to be involved, and they don't even know what's coming down the line in terms of new technology. So we have a real education role here as well in this process. So we have been challenged by our board to really say what would be the home runs that might come out of this process, because it really needs to be defined by the outcomes, the policies, programs, and projects that would actually be recommended by the document, by the overall process. So some of the technology-enabled mobility options that might come out is how do we make better use of connected and big data technology to manage our highway, freeway system reliability. CDOT is already working on that, but there's a lot more that could be done, and it is inhibited right now because it's a new program and doesn't always show up in the funding stream of the agencies. In terms of really looking at the RTD rail system and how do we make best use of that investment as technology changes, there's some real challenges there. We want to make sure that we allow mobility, alternative mobility, to really address the first and last mile demand that we've never been able to solve in using that rail system. We all know we get, you know, we live close, we work close, but not close enough if it's a half a mile or a mile away. And that last half a mile or a mile has been the devil that has always challenged the effectiveness of rail transit systems. With new mobility, we think we can have some on-demand solutions that are even more affordable than some of the public transit solutions today. And then finally, we want to make sure that whatever we do, we increase shared vehicle trips and increase vehicle occupancy. I think there's a real danger with the new technology, on-demand Uber and Lyft kind of service that becomes automated, its cost is going to drop. I mean, we could end up with more vehicles on the road. We could end up with more vehicle miles traveled, and I don't think that's the kind of result we want to see here in this region. And certainly an important way to do that, that really isn't, maybe you wouldn't think of it as a transportation project, but integrated electronic payment of all of the different ways that I can travel, you know, one card, one smartphone that I can tap on every vehicle that I want to travel on. Think about how that might change your behavior in the future. If I could get an Uber or Lyft or an automated vehicle and just sign up for it on the phone, tap the phone when I get on the light rail system, tap the phone when I get off to use another form of transportation, get a bike share, all united. That sounds like such a great idea that it must be impossible to do. Well, it's close to impossible, but I think it can be done, and other cities and other regions are really starting to work on this, as well as a lot of private sector companies. But it's a real challenge. It could make a huge difference. So those are big technology outcomes that might come out of this process. In terms of some of the public policy and program, if we could go to the next one, Doug, thanks. We want to make sure that this is a little bit challenging. I think we all have our, you know about the regional transportation plan. We know about the TIP. And what this is really saying is for 15 months, we're going to call a timeout. We're going to say, that might be how we want to spend our money over the next 15 and 25 years. But maybe it's not when we learn a little bit more about changing technology. So we want to make sure that the new mobility options really take advantage of the efficiencies so that we can address and provide better mobility to disadvantaged populations. It's not so clear to me that when the private sector starts to provide more mobility service, that a lot of the people that can't afford it are going to be left behind. And it's going to be very challenging, I think, as it becomes more privatized. How does the public sector still work with companies like Uber and Lyft so that they provide service not just to the people that can afford it, but also to the workforce that we need to get to their jobs, to do everything that's needed in this region? I would hope that we can strategically align investments among the three different organizations, three different agencies, especially taking into consideration new mobility technologies. I talked about the need for private sector participation in this process. The Chamber is putting up money equal to the other agencies. And there's another private aspect of this, and I just talked about it more and more. Transportation and mobility is not just going to be a public function. It's going to be provided by a partnership between the public and private sectors as we see more rideshare and on-demand private services emerge as part of our overall mobility system. There's more. We want to make sure that we're looking at our existing funding and new funding models if we need to have them. This is not a region that's blessed by plenty of transportation money. I know that. I was at CDOT. CDOT's on a maintenance budget. RTD is on a maintenance program, having built out this particular round of fast tracks. And DRCOG is limited to the money that comes in through the federal government, the federal share. So I know we're not blessed with a lot of funding, and I think part of this project has to look at new funding models as well if we find new investments that would really make a difference. So at the end, it may have an impact on our transportation policies, programs, and projects. And I would ask you all to open up your minds to that for this 15 or 18 month period so that we can do a great job to really shake out where we should be spending our money. So I didn't mean to put this in, poor Chrissy, rub it in. Was it 78 city applicants across the country for the Smart City Grant. Denver, well done. Final seven, and worked really hard on the proposal. But you knew when they said there would only be one winner, there were going to be six final losers. And I want to really congratulate the City and County of Denver and everything they did. Proud of what I saw presented to the USDOT. But just to show you, this has all emerged, this whole Smart City initiative by the U.S. Department of Transportation, kind of inside this time period we've been talking about, mobility choice. If you wouldn't object, Chrissy, we're going to show the Columbus Smart City grant pitch that was presented to the USDOT. And I think you'll see how much overlap there is with what we're talking about. So I don't know that Columbus had the a really different technical proposal than Denver did. For whatever reason, and maybe we'll find out someday why Columbus was chosen, but I do want to make the point that so much of what we're talking about, connecting, cutting edge, smart mobility,
is the enormous diversity of the country.
That's a presentation after mine. So I'll just closing thought, and then I'm going to ask Deborah Perkins-Smith a question. So we can't predict the future. There's no question about it. I used this slide, I think, when I was here 6 months ago, probably. But it's our job to be prepared for it. And I think more than ever before, we're at a watershed moment, a moment of change in mobility, that we really owe it to ourselves to be ready for it. We don't have now $140 million like Columbus does to do what they're going to do. If we do the funding of this project, we'll have $2 million to get a great start. But I'll tell you what, for $2 million, I'll put my money on the Denver metro region over Columbus any day. So, Deborah, I wanted you to bring us up to date on where CDOT is with its financial commitment.
Thanks, Don. So we're the first agency that stepped up. You know, Shailen wants to be number one in the U.S. in terms of DOT, so we're stepping up here. We've committed 500,000, so half a million, to this effort already. And I can tell you why CDOT and Shailen really support this. There are two things. One, it really complements our RoadX program that we've been talking about in terms of innovation. It fits very nicely with it. The second thing is, it is really hard, as you know, when you do planning, it's really hard to get the private sector involved. And in this case, we've got a willing partner to come together with us through the chamber, and it really opens up those opportunities with the private sector, both in terms of some of the largest employers within the metro area, but also secondly, those employers that are in transportation innovation. The closer we can be to them, the more likely we are to move ahead faster. So we were really, really excited to have the opportunity to do this. You know, we also, too, partnered with the City and County of Denver on the Smart City Challenge. You know, my thing is now we learned from that, so we're going to move on, and we're going to be the smart region, right? So we've kicked in our money, and we hope, Dr. Cog, we'd really like to see you as a partner because you bring all the local agencies to that. You know, as a state agency, we really need the partnership in terms of the local governments here to make this all work, so.
Thanks. So, Chairwoman Jones, we stand ready for questions.
Excellent. Chrissy. Sorry, Director Fanganella.
Thank you. There is a Denver commercial, so you might want to watch that one, too, in addition to Columbus. We did work really hard. I think the Denver proposal put together a regional approach, so that's something. We have an executive summary. I think it's online. I was talking to someone about it today, so it might be worth looking at and watching our video as well, just to see what the similarities are with Columbus. There were three things that I wanted to mention with regards to Columbus and their win and where we are right now and what the Chamber is proposing moving forward. One place, while the technical applications were not all that different, one area where we were very different was the $140 million. There was $40 million available from USDOT and $10 million available from the Vulcan Foundation. They brought the other $90 million. The Denver package was at about $84 million, so we certainly were trying to leverage those dollars, but we did not have the leverage that a city like Columbus did. So I applaud the Chamber and Kelly and Don for doing this work. I think that the private sector is a really critical component to this, I'm also really excited that we have this opportunity, and we might have a bit of a playbook that we're certainly willing to share with those guys as they move forward in terms of how we might move forward and get an input from the entire region. I think that was one of the hardest things with our approach was really very regional in nature, but in a very short amount of time, we probably didn't get around to as many people as we wanted to or needed to. The good news is, to not winning, I was sharing this with Jennifer Schaffel earlier tonight, is we don't have to spend probably 3,000 reports over to the U.S. Department of Transportation. So thank you, USDOT, for not having so many reports to move forward. But I do think we have a huge opportunity to really come together as a region, not only from the public sector side, but as a private sector side, to do this and hit it out of the park. And that's kind of what I've been telling everyone. We didn't hit that ball, but there's another one coming, so let's get ready and send it out.
Thanks. Director Sonanic?
Thanks, Don and Chrissy, for all the comments, as well as Deborah. In discussing this in my community, with a few folks, just a few at this point in time, Don, one of the things that often isn't considered when you're dealing with transportation solutions is it tends to be, how do you get from point A to point B and connect those? What was brought up in the conversation is, what's the experience that folks are going to have? What are the opportunities for that time when they're in transit? And how do we move that so that folks will indeed make good choices?
And I don't, I'm not sure I have the answer to that today, but I'll go back to the just the number of passengers per vehicle. I think that if we let this go without any kind of public intervention, public policy, we're going to end up with a lot more single occupant vehicles and a lot of people left behind. So that's why I would make the argument it has to be a public-private partnership. And then you get into, as there's more private transportation, you know, what rules and what regulations? We've let Uber and Lyft operate fairly openly, I think, to give them a chance to be successful. How do you modify that in the future so it serves everybody?
One item that's come up, though, is the ubiquitousness of, or the lack of ubiquitousness of Wi-Fi while folks are in transit, and what that does when they lose elements of connection and how that can change the experience while they're in transit.
That's a very good point. A lot of the upside here is that we will gain all sorts of new time while we travel, but it's hard to gain it if you don't have Wi-Fi access. Yep. Good point.
Yes.
I'd like to ask a noob question. Looking at your organization, I don't see Denver in the middle of this. And I just, is there a particular reason? Or maybe I shouldn't even ask this question.
No, you should ask it. It's a really good question. Obviously, the City and County of Denver has had a lot of experience that a lot of us have not over the last 6 to 12 months. However, we have a governance structure, I think, that we have to respect from a regional point of view. So we've met with Chrissy and a couple other folks in Denver about how the city can participate at a level commensurate with its experience and knowledge, but not in a way that in any way upsets the governance structure of this organization. We want to be fair to everybody. Just to add to that, Chrissy and I are working on a technology advisory committee. I think there will also be some kind of public outreach advisory committee that will provide opportunities for cities who are interested in this effort to directly interact with the process if you have the interest and the staff time to do it.
Thanks. Director Atchison.
Good evening, Don. Thank you and Kelly for coming in.
Hey there, Mayor.
Just kind of a follow-up, as we're trying to get this message out, it's not going to hurt to talk to anybody and everybody from any organization that does transportation work. So I'm going to encourage you, start with a group that goes down to your office, Kelly. That's that Metro Mayor's group. They're kind of a funky bunch. They all go down there and sit at your place and drink coffee. But Don, you and Kelly have got a great relationship with that group. I would also tell you that I'd start talking to all of the transportation committees that are around. They're, for the most part, most of the municipalities and counties are represented here. But the more voices that hear that message, the more likely are we can get a bigger group to get behind you. I would say talk to the US 36 group, talk to NADA, talk to the North I-25 group. Don't miss anybody. It's too important to us as a region that we don't get everybody on board.
Mayor, couldn't agree more. We've been to the Denver South EDP, scheduling with NADA right now. Audrey sent me an email today, and we're trying to set something up with US 36. So that has to be part of this, without a doubt. We also think there are further partnering opportunities with some of those organizations. Certainly Denver South EDP would like to play at a different level where they could actually have an impact on some of the products that might come out of this study.
Director Mulliken.
Thank you for coming. It sounds like Denver was able to secure $84 million worth of commitments for this particular project or the implementation. Will this process be looking at different funding sources, and what is that going to look like, and who are you looking at bringing to the table for that?
We're calling it funding models. I don't think that, and it's not going to be the job of this particular Mobility Choice Blueprint to recommend specific funding. But I think there are new funding models emerging that are public-private partnerships in a different sort of way than we've thought about mobility before. I'm very interested in talking to Chrissy about where all of her funding is coming from. Obviously, we have firms that have stepped up at the chamber and have contributed money in order to make this effort work. So I don't have the answer today, but those new funding models are going to be very important. It just can't land back in the laps of city and county officials to NCDOT and RTD to make this all happen.
Director Fanganello?
To clarify, it was $84 million package total, so that included the 50. So we plussed it up by about 30. But I would say that one of the things that we are hearing from folks that were interested in participating in Denver is they still want to participate in Denver. So just because we didn't win doesn't mean they don't want to come. So I think having this conversation right now is really an important one, and again, can be made much, much stronger because we have potentially the region behind us.
Director Christman?
I don't know how aggressive you're going to be in identifying roadblocks, but it would be helpful if, along with the program, you identify where cities and regions are going to have to change how and what they do to accommodate this. I'm looking at this cute as a bug, but how is it going to do in 3 feet of snow when cities are not plowing side streets? And does this mean that they are now going to have to plow all streets? Where's that money coming from? I mean, just kind of what additional things is it going to take to make the system work? And who's going to fund that? So, or not? I mean,
that's another excellent question. You know, we haven't done all that well in funding the upkeep of our infrastructure, of our roadways. These vehicles will require probably smoother roads. Right now they're not handling potholes very well. Right now they need good striping in order to stay lane centered. There are all sorts of communication aspects that, you know, aren't solved yet. I would say that it's kind of like, and we don't know how they're going to handle snow, but there will be the issue, gee, I depend on that vehicle to get me from here to the train station. Now my local street isn't plowed. The particular vehicle can't handle six inches of snow like my old SUV. I can't go to work today. I've lost my service because I went down to one vehicle instead of having two vehicles. So I think there are a lot of questions about the roadblocks that will really make this a successful system.
All right, maybe last question. Go ahead.
What about the education piece? How I'm thinking, students are very smart. We have some really smart students around the state in Boulder and in Golden and DU and University of Colorado Health Sciences, and they might want to partner if you were to allow students to sit at your table and learn or even be a part of answering some of those questions, and maybe they could design a car that would get around in the snow that would be cheaper, easier, and cooler even looking. So I, you know, that's kind of where I'm thinking is maybe bring some of those educational pieces. I mean, you're going to have to teach people anyway. why not learn from students how to do that?
Two parts to that. I think one is the whole education area is as important as public outreach. This is a new idea that I think there has to be some level of education involved, and reaching out to the colleges, the university, very important. We're already talking about talking with the University of Denver. They're probably going to do a smart city symposium that we'll be a part of in a month or two, and University of Colorado as well is looking to be a partner, and we'll partner with whoever wants to come. We need all the help we can get. So really good point.
So I want to thank you again, Don and Kelly, for coming and laying this out and giving us some updates. Very exciting stuff. We're going to spend a few more minutes talking about on the board about whether or not we want to move this forward. I think Doug wants to talk a minute about funding.
Indeed.
I just want to acknowledge Doug and Jennifer, who have been a part of this and very supportive, and a lot of good points. Wouldn't be where we are without your help, so thank you.
Oh, thank you, sir, very much. Appreciate you all being here this evening. I would like to echo the comments that have been made about the Denver Smart City Challenge, the tremendous work they did. You have no idea how much that lady over there, Chrissy, spent, and her staff spent on that application, as well as Evan in the mayor's office. And it's the reason we're having this conversation this evening, to be honest with you, is because through that initiative, we saw the excitement about this topic. And I think it is, you know, it's something, it's new. You know, I don't get to do a lot of cool stuff, and this is cool. And so I kind of like that from that perspective. Yeah, just talk about next steps and everything with regards to, you know, this is just a briefing this evening, but we would like to get kind of your general reaction that this is a path that you all would like to go down. You know, we anticipate if that is indeed the case, that we would bring back a formal action next month, which would involve a approval of staff to do an administrative modification to put the $500,000 in the TIP. And you're probably all wondering, where is that $500,000 coming from? No one asked the question, but I know you're thinking it. And you're right. Typically, we don't have $500,000 just sitting around. But the timing actually is pretty good for us, because we received some additional funds from the FAST Act, the Authorization Act, as well as some returns from some projects that came in under budget. So that was good. And as you know, we have a process for allocating that, if we have a balance of money, to waiting list projects on our TIP, and you will be seeing that, because we have about $20 million actually that we will be allocating, and you will see that TIP amendment in the next, I think we're scheduled for September to do that. So we would allocate $500,000 of that money towards this study. So I just wanted that to be clear, where we're headed with that, and just happy, I mean, just really looking to see where you all would like to go with this.
So we're going to spend just a few minutes getting reactions on whether or not we would like to direct staff to bring something to us to consider formally in September. And I'll just kick it off by saying I think this is very exciting, and this is exactly the kind of thing that, in my mind, DRCOG should be involved with, looking at the future where technology is taking us. And I think Don's point about technology won't necessarily get us everything we want. We actually have to guide it and make sure it delivers on the things that we want. And then it's this incredible tool that we can harness. And it makes sense to me for DRCOG to be at the table as one of the key partners moving this forward. So. Other comments on whether or not thumbs up on moving forward? Director Partridge.
I think Kelly brought up some excellent points talking about the partnership, but what I really see, this is a P3. What more do you see the state, the Dr. RTD business stepping in? That it's the perfect P3. What a great message. So I would say it's certainly an idea that we can build upon and look to support.
Other comments? Director Dozo.
I just have a couple of questions. What would the money be used for, and how much additional staff time will be required from DRCOG staff?
Good question. The money itself would be, we anticipate that this blueprint or this study, this plan, would we anticipate it's going to cost anywhere between $1 million and $1.5 million. We budgeted right now 1.5 we budgeted, but holding some back for contingency. But yeah, so that will be used for specifically for the plan, the monies from the three public entities, CDOT, RTD, and us.
To actually research it and create the documents and.
Correct. Oh, yes. That. Okay. Well, we would contract consultant services to do that. And for our staff time, we anticipate that, you know, Jennifer obviously will be serving on the board of Mobility Choice. I will be involved, as well as Deb and Bill, on the technical advisory committee or something of that nature that's set up. But, you know, other than really that, I mean, we will be following this process very closely, but we don't anticipate that staff time is going to be exorbitant.
Other comments? Director Fanganello?
In case it wasn't clear, Denver is definitely supportive of this moving forward and having it come to the board more formally to talk about the funds available. So thank you.
Did I say Director Christman?
I find this very exciting too, but we are a region, and I would really hope that this study also looks to regional issues. It does us no good to design a wonderful system that only works in Santa Monica. So we don't want to file this when we're done.
Right. No, I understand. No, that makes a lot of sense. And I will say, because we didn't mention this, that part of this plan process and the development of the plan, we will be coming back to the board frequently for updates, whether, you know, we can decide, you know, how often we want that. Maybe we can talk about that next month. But once the consultant is on board, they will be given regular updates on the progress of the plan to this committee to make sure that, you know, you guys are simpatico with the plan development.
Director Atchison?
Just kind of follow up with some of the things. I know that Don mentioned this. We recently, many of us on the north end, were sitting on a driverless car symposium on transportation not too long ago. And some of the challenges that Don mentioned, probably the biggest thing for the Colorado area is snow. But they are fairly confident that over a period of time that they'll be able to figure out how to read that striping, which is very important to the cars staying in the line. But I think those are things that we can overcome through technology over a given period of time. But Colorado is unique in that snow piece because we get so much of it on our roadways. But I think one of the things that we're looking at, very much like Laura was talking about, is we also have to keep in mind that we're going to have to make sure that we maintain our own municipal and county streets to the level that all of these vehicles in the future, whatever they are, can function the way they're designed to. So yes, we're going to have to do some planning on our part, whether it's in a county or municipality, either one. But if we do nothing, then we can expect nothing. And without taking a leap of faith that we're going to be able to plan ourselves into something that's going to be better for us in the future than just sitting around wringing our hands about it, we're going to fool ourselves. I'm very much in favor of us taking a hard look at this, asking staff to go back and bring us a proposal next month at the next meeting for us to have an opportunity to look at. But I think with what Kelly and Don and Chrissy and some of the others have done with the Smart City Challenge, that's given us one small step. We've got to take a much bigger step. But we as a region, as Laura was talking about, have got to do this as a partnership together. And it can't be just DRCOG, CDOT, and RTD. We really have to look at the general area of their front range. Where can we find business partnerships that are willing to step in? Whether it's from our college students, the first thing that popped in my head, is, as Kelly was talking about, is something similar to the NAOP challenge, a transportation-based challenge along the same way, and it opened it up to the schools as an opportunity for them to use their own engineers for it. At the NAOP challenge, we had 800 people that showed up to watch what two schools were ending up presenting. Those were all people from the private industry. If we can get that kind of an excitement thing going and open up some opportunities to further what we can bring out of the heads of these kids sitting in school all day, maybe they will find that answer to the snow. It might already be out there, they just don't know how to bring it forward. But we've got opportunities that we have to take advantage of when they come along, and I think this is one of those opportunities that we need to seriously look at. I'm going to strongly recommend that we propose the staff bring this back. $500,000 sounds a lot of money, but it's going to be a drop in the bucket what it's going to cost us if we don't do something smart.
So I'm hearing general support for moving forward, and we're going to need to wrap this conversation up pretty quickly. I saw Director Partridge wanted to speak. Is there anybody else who hasn't spoken that, or anybody that disagrees with moving forward, because we haven't heard any? So go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Maybe just a question for Don. Don, have you or do you plan to reach out to other COGs?
Yeah, I think we'd really be looking to Doug to help us do that. We've actually engaged industry, the consulting industry, engineers and management consultants who are practicing in this area now. We asked them, is this going on anywhere else in the country? And pretty much the answer came back, no. The Smart City Challenge has caused larger cities to look at the issue and then, as Chrissy mentioned, kind of engage with the region. But in terms of really looking at the investment of the three agencies are making in transportation and doing it at a regional level, so far no one is there. I'm sure we'll find some others that are starting to, or maybe they'll copy us. I don't know.
And Commissioner, I can answer that. I mean, I don't know if you meant from a financial commitment perspective. I don't believe so, because I think this is a regional plan for the Denver region. But however, we have had conversations. We have a statewide MPO group that meets monthly, and we've had discussions about this mobility choice, and they're very interested in the topic, and we're going to keep them apprised of that, because obviously anything that we create in this plan, or you know, they can use those recommendations as well. So we're going to be throwing stuff off that group all the time to kind of get the reaction.
All right, last comment maybe? Director Chair Graves.
So we have some really big brains out in Mines, you know, the school, Colorado School of Mines, and I think they'd be really excited about this, and City of Golden too.
All right, last
comment. I have one last comment on this, and that it snows in Cleveland also.
I'm at Columbus,
I guess. Excuse me, and so we might want to see how they do that. Yeah, it does too.
Great. All right, so just to sum up then, I'm hearing broad support, if not unanimous support, for moving forward to have staff bring us back something on this to look at funding our portion of the study. Great. Thanks again for coming. We look forward to the partnership. Yay. Okay, moving along, we are to our consent agenda. I'd consider a motion to approve.
Second.
Motion a second. All in favor?
Aye.
And moving on to the action agenda, we are going to start with a discussion of ballot initiatives. There were two in particular that were highlighted for possible Dr. Carg board positions. One of them, initiative number 117, has been pulled for inadequate funding. That's the statewide Tabor debrucing initiative. So sadly, in my point, from my point of view, we won't have an opportunity to take a position because it's not moving forward. Now, amendment number 69 is still moving forward. It's been certified, and I believe Jennifer's going to talk to us a little bit about that.
Just a very little bit, only to say that this was an item that you asked us to bring back to you to take a position on. The information about the for and against folks are in your package. Rich is not here tonight due to a death in his family, but. The big question is do you want to take a position on 69, and if you do, what position might that be? It's our understanding, I'll just go ahead and say too, it's our understanding that a number of councils and commissions around the region have taken a position on this initiative and have very soundly said no to it. So I don't know if that refreshes your memory about what may have gone on in your council or not.
Director Acheson.
Yeah, just to kind of bring some of you that may not be, this has been before the Metro Mayor's Caucus, and that decision was unanimous with every municipality represented, that there was a no vote on 69. We have had some interaction as well from my city with a number of the health care providers. This is a very negative thing for them and the impact it could be to them and the service that they provide to our underprivileged families and to other activities that they do to trying to serve the community in need. So that does not mean that this is a Dr. Cog position, but if you look around, since Metro Mayors represents just about everybody in this room in some form or fashion, whether it's a municipality or county, at least from that level, this position has been very emphatically stated that it's a no position.
Director Partridge.
And dovetail off of that, and CCI also took a position of no.
So is it the board's pleasure that we want to take a position on this? And if so, I'd entertain
as
a
did CML. The municipal league, unanimous, no.
Okay. And
I'm a CPA by my day job. Just if you guys don't understand, if you think California's taxes are high, this would actually bring our effective tax rate to about 14.63%, which is about a percent and a half over the California's top rate. No matter what we're spending it on, I mean, that's two to three times more than what we're paying now.
Director Christman.
Well, when I have my mayor's hat on, I'm opposed to 69. If I put on my director's hat for Dr. Cog, I need someone to explain to me within what Dr. Cog does, which is transportation and senior services, why is this bad? So I can, with that hat on, understand
if
it.
If my memory serves, this wasn't an item that staff brought to you to take a position on. It was brought to the body by a member of the body, and so and in that there was no I don't think that there was any dissent that we didn't bring it back to you to take a look at. But I will tell you that Rich Morrow is very diligent in looking at legislation on the state side, seeing what Congress is doing, working with their contract lobbyists in Washington, as well as looking at initiatives like this. And I'm confident that Rich brings to you what he believes is germane to the work of Dr. Cog. So, like I said, if recollection serves me correctly, Rich didn't bring this to you for your position. It was requested by a member of the board to bring it back to you to take a position on.
Okay.
Well, can I just follow up then? Unless you were, then I guess the question is not whether or not we like this initiative. It sounds like a number of folks are part, most everybody's a part of an organization that's opposed it. Is it germane to Dr. Cog's mission, or is this scope creep? I understand a board member said, hey, it'd be great for us to take a position, but is it related to our mission? And I guess I heard Director Christman asking staff's opinion on whether or not Dr. Cog has a dog in this fight. Let's hear from staff, and then we'll.
Well, I'm trying to think back of all the words that are in the mission. I think that an argument could be made. But is this the type of thing that we would normally bring? No, it's not. And if it was, Rich would have brought it forward for your consideration. So certainly there would be a, just like for all of you as employers, as well as local governments, there is an impact to your budget by this, and there would be here at Dr. Cog as well. But as this is not something we would normally bring to you if we thought it was directly germane to the mission and core business of the organization. Rich would have brought it to you.
Okay. Director Beacom.
In looking through the proposed amendment and considering that we also have the AAA, which is a health-related activity, I'm not sure exactly what the economic impact would be on our service there of that, but I'm sure it would drastically impact it because it would be a separate activity going on in the state of Colorado, taking all the money that's available for any health care. And then secondary to it, it would be taking all the money that is available in Colorado for transportation. And if you take away those two sources, because it's going to take all the money in Colorado to pay for it, there's nothing else. It's either 69 or we have the rest of our life. So my only comments.
So just to move us along, would somebody like to put a motion on the table? Director Acheson.
Yeah, I would move that the board adopt the position of opposition to the amendment being proposed, 69.
Second. Any further discussion? I'm going to put in that I will be abstaining just because Boulder County is still in the process of trying to determine the impact to our particular county, and we're not through with that, so I will be abstaining. I see Director Rocket and then Director Stolzman.
I was just going to say the same thing, that my council has not yet considered whether or not we'll be supporting this, so I will also be abstaining.
I had my hand up first before you mentioned that you were abstaining, but we talked about this at council last night, and we did not have time to take up any positions on anything, and so they asked if I would abstain from any of the voting on different positions tonight.
Okay. Director Pitt.
I will also abstain because our council hasn't taken a position either.
Okay. Further discussion? If not, we have a motion on the table to oppose. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Uh-oh. All right. So sorry, my bad.
You all are abstaining because that's going to affect whether or not.
Do you want to hear how many? Should we do the vote in the affirmative then? Just have people raise their hand? Okay. Abstentions, hold your hands high. Okay. So I don't know if we heard that, because there's so many abstentions, we don't have enough to take an affirmative vote on this. So I think we'll leave it for now. If people feel strong, I suppose it could be an option for us to revisit that in September, and maybe jurisdictions will have considered it by then. So then we'll move on to the 2016-2021 TIP amendments.
Good evening. So attachment E contains a total of 9 amendments for your consideration tonight. And staff has organized these into 2 separate sets. The first set of 5 amendments apply the second commitment in principle, or skip funding, to fast tracks for the Northwest Corridor. So back in 2008, $60 million in DRCOG funding was approved by the board for 11 fast tracks corridors for funding over 2012 to 2019. To date, 7 corridors have complete allocation, while 3 have yet to be funded, and these amendments contained in your packet tonight will provide additional funding for the Northwest Corridor. So your agenda contains 3 attachments. Attachment 1 is the 2008 resolution authorizing this funding. Attachment 2 is the Northwest Corridor Partners request. And attachment 3, pages 1-6, contain the TIP amendments to remove the funding from the second commitment and principal pool and add it to new projects. And these include 3 railroad quiet zone crossings and 1 railroad bridge replacement. The remaining amendments are from CDOT Region 4, and these are to clarify funding in the TIP by removing some pool projects. The removal of these pool projects ensure that all projects funded in the TIP are shown in the year they were programmed and not necessarily in the year that they were anticipated to be expended. These pool projects are being removed, were already shown in a previous TIP, and are now being shifted over to and shown in the expanded rollover list. The expanded rollover list is a detailed listing of projects that were shown in a previous TIP but are still open for funding charges. So in total, all of these amendments presented were recommended by both TAC and RTC, and all the amendments conform with the state implementation plan for air quality. Is there any questions that you may have?
Questions? Director Pfeiffer.
Maybe it's a dumb question, but since I have a lot of trains go through my city, I'd like to understand why we're funding quiet zones.
They're federally eligible, and the Northwest Corridor, or the corridor partners, agreed to. So that might be more of a question I could turn over to the sponsors of the projects.
So let me just add some clarification. I hate to bring up a sore point, but the Northwest Corridor has not yet gotten its fast tracks promise for Northwest Rail, with the exception of getting it to Westminster, which we'll celebrate in a week. And so we are using our allocation on something that will both benefit rail when that actually gets to us, if it does, assuming it does, but also provides some utility to us now in the short term. And quiet zones and providing for those railroad crossings is one of those things that is a twofer and will provide immediate benefits to our residents through the quiet zones, but also will make the tracks ready for when Northwest Rail comes, if that makes sense.
I don't see the direct relation to transportation in that particular part. I mean, we paid for all of our quiet zones, and we have a dozen more on three different rail lines. And other than RTD's partnership, we've paid for our own, and I just don't understand why we're funding another community's quiet zones. That's just, to me, just doesn't make sense. But if it was resurfacing, widening a road, improving capacity, those kind of things, but I don't see a quiet zone improving transportation objectives. That's just, maybe I'm the dumb guy in the room, but I'm trying to figure that out because I paid the $250,000 times 12 quiet zones.
Are you getting rail anytime soon?
But yeah, we are getting it.
Exactly. Director Stolzman.
But my quiet zones were not on that. I wasn't done with my comments before I was called.
I appreciate it. So we're taking money from our fast tracks pool and using it for this. So once our pool's expended, we won't have additional funding in the pool. And the environmental impact assessment for our section of rail requires that we have quiet zones because there's an increase in noise associated with the increase in transit that we expect to receive at some point. So we are getting the environmental impact solved ahead of time, but it's something that has to be done in association with the project. Anyway, it's a requirement of completing the project, so we will be able to benefit from this immediately, where we won't see the benefits of the transit until 2042 or later. So it is part of the project, and it is within the scope of work, and we're taking from our fast tracks pool, which you've already expended your funds from that and gotten rail. So I appreciate that you don't value this portion of the project, but it's part of what needs to be completed to complete the rail line.
Director Pfeiffer and then Director Rakowski.
First and foremost, I think Denver, Westminster, and Arvada, and Wheat Ridge understand that our quiet zones did not happen in time. So yours, who may not ever happen, you're going to be years ahead. I don't get the rationale. It just doesn't work for me. But I'll heed to.
Okay. Director Rakowski.
Move to approve.
Do we have a second? So we have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Director Partridge.
As I understand, many times with quiet zone, there's an ongoing maintenance cost. Has that been addressed regarding quiet zones?
Within this TIP project, I am not sure if that ongoing cost has been addressed. That would be something that they would address with CDOT during the construction of the IGA.
Director Teeter?
Yes, I would also like to agree with Director Pfeiffer from Arvada. Commerce City also paid for their quiet zone.
Excuse me. Yeah, probably. Do you want to? All right. Well, why don't you?
I was just asking the chair if it was worth refreshing people's memory about the second commitment. And staff is certainly here to tell me if I'm wrong. But the second commitment in principle, like the first, basically was an agreement between DRCOG and the jurisdictions along the corridors to kind of figure out what the corridors wanted or needed to spend the money on. They had to get together on their own and figure out what that particular corridor's highest and greatest priorities were. That was an agreement between all the cities and counties on the corridor, as well as RTD if they were impacted, as well as CDOT, which has often been the case. So all of those jurisdictions had to come together and say, this is what we want to do. There wasn't, outside of some pretty broad guidelines about it being fast tracks related, there weren't any specific policies or guidance that the board gave the corridors other than this is to help you get your corridor done. So maybe, you know, if additional commitments are requested in the future, you know, maybe some sort of guidance on what that might look like would be something you'd want to do. But for those first and second commitments in principle, there wasn't any kind of there wasn't any kind of guidance.
Director Brockett.
So my understanding is that this work will need to be done eventually in order to complete the fast tracks rail through to Boulder and then on to Longmont. So it's a required piece of that project, so it is transportation related. When we eventually do get rail 25 years from now or so, this will have to be done. So we're just getting a piece of it done that actually benefits us in the short term right away, but it does have an eventual transit function. If we were getting rail at the same time as many other corridors, this would be being done anyway. We're just front-loading it a little bit so we get some benefit now, like many other communities are at this time.
Director Partridge, and then anybody else who hasn't had a chance to speak on this? Okay.
I say, Douglas County also, we did actually cooperation with a couple of an HOA and a metro district in combination for quiet zones. But I think certainly, Director Pfeiffer, I sympathize with the issue raised. But I believe the TAC certainly had a very good conversation of this and my understanding of it. And I think Director Brock and Director Solson bring up some very good points. So, Todd, were you in attendance with the TAC meeting? And can you go a little bit more into their technical discussion? Because I think Director Stoltzman hit it. There's a lot more at stake here, and meeting the EIS ahead of time, maybe before changes are made to the EIS, how complicated it would be later down the line. Would you at least comment on that?
Well, I don't know if I can go into the process of the EIS. I mean, I think what's most important here, at least from our...
More with what the TAC discussion was, not necessarily EIS, but more really what the TAC discussion was.
Director Partridge, to be honest with you, I don't remember there being a whole lot of discussion about this item at TAC, but I will echo what Jennifer mentioned earlier with regards to, you know, this pool was set up back in 2008 specifically to complement and prepare the future fast track lines for that capital investment that is going to happen. And, you know, so for example, Director Pfeiffer mentioned, you know, roads or, you know, capacity improvements or anything. Quite frank, I think that would be ineligible for this pool. I'll give you the example of the North Metro line and some of the work that they're doing up there. They've used like sidewalk connections and you know, connections to the platforms and those types of things in order to prepare for the North Metro line opening. So really, it has to be germane to that fast tracks corridor and the ultimate completion of that corridor. Yeah, but again, I don't recall at least there being a lot of discussion at TAC on this item.
So I think I saw Director Stoltzman's hand up, and then anybody else? It's probably about time to vote.
I just had two other quick things to add. Louisville is paying for one of its crossings outside of this, but I think that's actually a moot point because there's all kinds of projects that come up that, you know, one jurisdiction pays for themselves and really prioritizes, and another group submits it for TIP application and things like that. So I mean, there's all kinds of things we've approved that, you know, we've approved underpasses, we've always paid for our underpasses. We've approved sidewalk connections. You know, we may have paid for our sidewalk connection and not this or that. So I sort of think that that piece of it is not the key thing to focus on. I think it's really that there's money sitting to be put toward fast tracks and not being put toward fast tracks, and the people in this region are committing money toward fast tracks and not receiving a benefit from it. So this is really a way to represent a small token to say, you know, here is some of the money that's sitting in the bank that's meant to go toward this project that will enable the completion of this project at some point, and you can enjoy some benefit today, even though it's not the benefit that you were expecting when you approved the tax. So I think it's a small token, and it will help work toward the completion of the project.
Director Atchison and then Director Pfeiffer.
Just to kind of go along with, you know, this is money that's predicated to this particular corridor. It's not money you can take and put into another corridor. It can only be spent here. The decision of how to spend it was left to all of the elected bodies of this corridor, and you have a letter that's in your file that is signed by a representative of every elected body in that corridor saying that we have all come together, as Jennifer indicated, as a single body, and this is what we have made a decision that is best for this corridor at this time with this amount of funding we have available. We can't spend it outside the corridor. You can't move it to somebody else and let them spend something else. We are doing preparatory work for what we hope to realize someday in the future, hopefully before most of us in this room die, that we have a completed transit system. And Longmont, I know, wants it. I know the city of Brighton would like to have transit. It's not going to all get there, but we have to start looking at how we can best utilize the funds we have available. This is not only a transportation issue, but it's darn well a safety issue, that we have issues of people coming to these crossings that are not protected. We have seen many times across the nation of what happens when one of these passenger trains hits an unprotected vehicle. Lives are lost. We're trying to get ahead of this game and get some of this stuff put into place sooner than later.
So Director Pfeiffer, and then I'm going to strongly encourage us to go to a vote just because we're running.
I appreciate the conversation, not being aware of all your governments coming together other than the letter. And I appreciate the conversation. I just expect, and it's not about who pays for what. The point I was trying to make was, we as a city did not feel that it's up to Dr. Cog's responsibility to pay for our quiet zones. We look at Dr. Cog to improve our trails, our site, you know, our trail system, our road capacities, our connectivity amongst the region, and not to the betterment of a quiet zone, which I have three rail lines that go through our city, and trust me, I hear all the horns that go through. So that was my main point. I'm not going to argue with the leaders of that community that that's where they feel that money is spent. I just felt it should have been spent to something to improve today on something that, unfortunately, I don't think I'll be alive when that rail line gets up there. I don't have a lot of hope. So I'll go ahead and support the motion with that, but I just wanted to make sure my voice was heard.
Thank you, Director Pfeiffer. Are we ready for a vote? We have a motion to approve. We have a motion to approve in a second. So all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? The motion carries. And then we're on to the Unified Planning Work Program for 2016-2017.
Yes, thank you very much, Madam Chair. The work program, as you all know, it really outlines the task and activities for staff as well as our member partner agencies to fulfill the mission of the MPO. And we create this document every 2 years, and we're halfway through the first year. And periodically, we do come to you once we have a better feel for where we are within the current fiscal year to amend the UPWP to make the best and most effective use of staff. So we have for your consideration this evening some amendments, and it was sent to you as a link in your agenda packet, and they really fall into three general categories. The first is primarily procedural, mostly administrative stuff, changing Map 21 references to the new FAST Act. Now that we have a better understanding exactly what's included within that authorization, we also have some minor clarifications and edits to tasks that are included within activities. We've actually added a few tasks in order to fulfill the mission of some of the activities included in your document. The largest probably change is on the financial tables, which are included in Appendix A. Traditionally, what we've always done here is like we have seven major objectives in our Unified Planning Work Program, and we show the federal share for each of those objectives as well as the local match and the in-kind contribution that we receive. We're going through our federal certification process now. Actually, it started back in February, and one of the things we talked about in those meetings was providing more detail on the financial table. So what we've done is actually included the financial information, the breakdown by activity within the objective, and we think it looks pretty good, and we were happy to do it. So I just wanted to point that out to you. And last but not least, in Appendix B, we did change some of the schedule for deliverables. We did move up some deliverables that we felt we could do within this current fiscal year, and we also moved some back. And that was, again, just to balance staff time and what have you. But all the deliverables and products that are in the UPWP will be completed at the conclusion of that UPWP in 2017. So that is really it. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have about any of the edits. Madam Chair.
Any questions? If there are no questions, we would entertain a motion. All right. I think Shakti said so moved. All right. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second, and further discussion. All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? The motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. Now we'll move on to a discussion of the HOV policy. And Jacob.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board. So in the interest of time, I have some good news. I'm not going to give the presentation unless you'd like me to. But what I will say is a couple of things. This was discussed thoroughly at our Transportation Advisory Committee. We have a recommendation from them that we then took to the board work session. The PowerPoint presentation that we gave to the board work session is in your packet. There haven't been any changes to the presentation or the content since that time. So it's been vetted through the board work session. Yesterday, our DRCOG Regional Transportation Committee, which also includes CDOT and RTD, discussed this in detail. They also recommend approval. So again, I can go into details if you want me to, but sort of bottom line is that we're asking for you to approve the updated additional information requirements for our regional transportation plan for projects that want to be in the regional transportation plan that have a tolling component. And those updates involve both sort of clarifying kind of content updates. The original material was back from 2009, but we've also done some work with TAC and the other committees to incorporate the concept of high occupancy vehicles and the work that CDOT is doing on their HOV policy, which is also in your packet as the first attachment, to incorporate those within the RTP requirements. So with that, unless anyone wants me to go through the presentation, I'll just open it to questions.
Thank you, Jacob. Questions? Director Cernanek.
Just on this point, Jacob, which is we had a significant discussion at the work session that I'm not sure it necessarily gets covered, which is trying to get to a more user-friendly approach as opposed to by road approach on what is being done with regard to the toll side of it, as well as making sure that the users have a better understanding of what the HOV requirements would be. I didn't necessarily see that captured here, but since Deborah's present, you know, maybe we could just at least surface that. And if there's no other comments, I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay. What I'll just say in response, it's a good point. Both through this conversation and through some other things in the FAST Act that Doug mentioned, our transportation reauthorization, we've been working and talking a little bit more closely with HPTE staff. And so this is something that we can kind of bring to them and coordinate with them as we go forward on it. Absolutely.
Director Christman.
Perhaps you could clarify for me, if it turns out that there are safety issues or whatever, all the exemptions, does that mean some places it'll be free and other places it won't be free? Or, because I think that's very confusing for somebody who's driving. They think it's free. For some people, it won't make any difference, but for some people who made a mistake thinking it's free, it might cause them then to go out of the lane unlawfully or get really upset when they get the bill. So, I mean, is that the plan so that we're going to have some free lanes and not some and not others?
So, in kind of broad terms, the part of what we're proposing here is building on some of the work that CDOT has done with their HOV policy from last fall. And again, that's in your packet as attachment one. I believe what you're referring to, Director, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that in the CDOT policy, it begins with the assumption, again, this is, you know, from CDOT side on CDOT facilities, beginning with the assumption of having HOV 2+ and as of 2017, 3+ on facilities, but recognizing that each project is unique and that there are, you know, specific circumstances on a case-by-case basis, and it does allow for a few exceptions, three exceptions. One of those exceptions is if indeed there is a safety concern, that's something that can be looked at in that project. So I think what we're all trying to do is strike that balance between sort of uniform expectations, which I think Director Cernanek is also getting out of, you know, less confusion on the user end, but also recognizing that, you know, for particular projects in particular locations, that there are issues that can arise, like safety and like other things that need to be considered.
Other comments? So, so Jacob, I think you explained that very well. I just want you to know, or Dr. Cog, members to know that there was extensive discussion at Transportation Commission and many meetings of the Transportation Commission where this issue was discussed. And the consistency among quarters was one of the things that that they came down on, that they wanted the quarters to be consistent. So they all go to 3+. Rather than having some 2 and some 3. So that is part of the consistency part. But on the other hand, you don't want to tie your hands in terms of being able to fund these corridors or safety or other issues. So to provide a little bit of flexibility in there as well.
Great, thanks. Are we ready for a motion? We have a motion
second.
And we have a second. Further discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
All right. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. And now we move on to the Metro Vision 2040 performance measures and strategic initiatives. Hello, Brad.
Thank you, Madam Chair. No presentation this evening, but I do have some talking points that I'll make sure, because I know some of you have been more involved in this process than others, so to make sure you know exactly what you're being asked to take action on this evening. So this evening's requested action is really kind of the third in a series of actions that the board has taken this year on the Metro Vision Plan, which is sort of our aspirational long-range plan for growth and development in this region. As noted in the memo, the board previously took action in both January and I believe in May on 5 overarching themes, 14 shared outcomes, 17 regional objectives, and a series of supporting objectives related to those as well. Since that last action by the full board in May, work session participants have been furiously working on what really is kind of in front of you this evening. There are really kind of three remaining elements using Dr. Cog's strategic planning framework that we need to discuss this evening. And those elements are performance measures for the plan, performance targets, and strategic initiatives. So the attachment that comes with your memo sort of lays out two things, sort of that top part, and hopefully you'll see it on the left-hand side. Those are actions that the board has already taken, and then the bottom half are really the things that we're asking you to consider this evening, both those measures as well as that very long list of strategic initiatives. You will note, if you're flipping through that attachment, that a lot of the information is organized both by theme and by outcome. So, for instance, what we're asking for approval this evening are 13 performance measures. Those are largely oriented towards the actual overarching theme. So The first theme has three outcomes, so you'll see those measures three times, and then you'll get to the next theme, which is a connected multimodal region. You'll see another set of performance measures related to that, versus the initiatives were actually oriented more by outcome. And I know that can be confusing, but just so you kind of understand why you might see some repetition, particularly in the measures piece, there are 13 measures for those five themes that I mentioned. As I mentioned, so 13 performance measures. For those that really wanted to do a deeper dive, there was a link in the memo to a data dictionary. That's something that came up. And one of the work session discussions is help us understand kind of where the data is coming from, what the sort of methodology is of how we're going to do the measurement, that sort of thing, how it's calculated. So if you're really wonky, that was in there for you. So in addition to those measures, you're also being asked to consider a set of strategic initiatives or ideas for implementation, also for inclusion in the draft plan that we will release for public review and comment and eventually board action in the coming months. These initiatives are a set of voluntary actions available to organizations to advance the region towards those shared outcomes that the board has previously discussed and approved back in January. You know, as noted in the memo and also hopefully in the attachment, it's best to think of these initiatives as kind of a menu of options. The idea is that they'll be pursued when they're consistent with the mission, vision, and priorities of the organization that would choose to pursue them. They're not intended to apply to everyone all the time and be universal. It really is, does this match up with where you're trying to go locally? And hopefully that contributes to the region getting to where we want to be as well. And then the final thing that we're putting in front of you this evening is something that we've been affectionately calling the preamble. In addition to those elements that are really directly related to our strategic planning model, like outcome performance measures, work session participants really wanted to kind of understand what the intro text might look like for the plan, really to kind of understand something that would address the role and limits of the Metro Vision Plan. What is it trying to do? How is it accomplished? What those sorts of things. So the work session folks talked about that document both in May and in July, with some substantive comments coming in July. And so those have actually been integrated with what's in your packet. There was one sentence that they gave, the work session folks gave us a little license to staff to come up with the sentence. So that's been added. That's in the second to last paragraph. The last sentence of that paragraph is something that staff came up with after the meeting, but it is included within the packet this evening. So in summary, staff is requesting approval for three items for inclusion in the draft Metro Vision Plan. Plan performance measures, including targets, strategic initiatives, so that very long list of voluntary options, and again, that introductory text to the draft plan, also known is the preamble. All three items come with a preliminary endorsement from work session participants. Happy to take questions. The memo does include a proposed motion.
Thank you, Brad. Any questions for staff? No questions. All right, comments. Director Acheson and then Director Cernanik.
Now I'm going to move the motion to approve the Metro Vision 2040 plan draft performance measures, strategic initiatives, the menu of the voluntary options available to organizations, and the preamble as attached and outlined in attachment one.
And I'll second.
Phil, did you want to say any more than that, Director?
We've gone through wordsmithing this on a number of occasions. I'm satisfied with where the words are. May not be exactly my words, and look forward to seeing it when we get in the final document form. Thank you.
I'm going to insert myself, and then I'll recognize you, Deborah. I too just want to take a moment to thank folks for the incredible amount of work, and we've been spending a lot of time on this over a year. God, it feels like two.
Let's not talk about it.
But at any rate, I wasn't able to attend the last work session, but I understand there was great discussion there too, and a lot of heavy lifting done by both staff and board members, and we're starting to see the fruits of our labor, and it's very exciting. And I just wanted to thank those of you who have been in the trenches working on this. Deborah?
When I looked through this packet, I thought this is really well done, and I'm able to like take out things that CDOT can use as well. So thank you for that. I wasn't fast enough. I do have a question, and maybe you can get back to me later. I noticed on when you talked about the connected multimodal region, you had in there a number of traffic fatalities. Does that also include bike? It's just that we're seeing a spike in bike, so I didn't know if that included bike as well.
Yes, it's all fatalities by all modes.
Thank you.
Yep.
So it's not just traffic.
Correct.
When you say traffic, you include bike.
Yes.
Director Dyack.
I want to thank Brad and the staff. It's been a long, arduous road, and Brad made a statement at the very beginning of this that you wouldn't take a vacation until this was done. Did you hold true to your word?
I have taken a vacation. to the chair's point, this has gone on for a while, and I can only deny myself for so long. So I had a lovely trip to Sweden in March, and if you haven't been, I highly recommend it.
Good to know. Sweet. Any additional comments before we take a vote? Oh, Director Partridge?
Certainly, we've all been through a long process on this, and I will echo my comments all along that I certainly think we have a lot of policy words in here that I'm concerned about all the way. And also, even though, as we state, it is a guiding document, individual jurisdiction can use as necessary, and even though it's not, there's things that encompass each and every separate entity to embrace or not. What I see that does tie us is, and it was my concern historically, is the TIP criteria has used MetroVision. So I do have grave concerns that we have policy statements in here, policy guidelines that will tie us all together, whether we want to be separate or not. But for the purpose of moving on as far as the draft, do support the motion.
Thank you, Director. All right. Feels like we're ready for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Well, congratulations.
Yay. First round's on Brad.
Yeah.
And donuts.
All right. Excellent. All right. Moving on to informational briefings, we have the Small Communities Hot Topics briefing that Flo is going to talk.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good evening. I'm Flo Rotano. I am the Director of Partnership Development and Innovation here at DRCOG. And back in April, Jennifer talked about a new undertaking that we have here at DRCOG, and that's working with our small communities to make sure that they feel like their voices are being heard and their needs are being met. And she directed staff to come up with a program to figure out what that meant. And so what we did is we created a poll that we sent to 22 identified target communities. And those communities were identified using three separate criteria, esoteric things like I borrowed Doug's smallest community TIP criteria of sales tax. We looked at population, which is a DOLA threshold, and we also looked at median household income. So using those three factors, we came up with our target list of 22 communities. So the poll was sent to those communities. We asked them to select their top five priorities out of a list of 20, and there was also the availability for them to add their own issues as well. And so in the analysis of the poll, we came up, we analyzed it three different ways, and what was absolutely fascinating to us is the three different methods of analysis still had all of the top five together. It just changed the relative rank order, but the top five issues were still the top five issues. And those issues were, to no one's great surprise, economic development, infrastructure in terms of water, sewer, the civic infrastructure that you have that is aging or needs to be expanded, funding strategies and finance options, things like tax increment financing, what does that mean anyway, what is gap financing, what is tiered financing, you know, what are all the instruments out there available to communities to use. Planning also ranked relatively high, and so that's understanding, you know, comp plans and building codes and what is this form-based code that everybody's talking about types of things. So planning came up as a topic, and of course, we wouldn't have a list of the top five without having transportation funding included, now would we? So that's a major area of interest to our smaller communities. With that, we have selected the date of September the 15th, it is a Thursday, that we will be hosting our first Small Communities Hot Topics Forum here at DRCOG. It's going to be a day-long event. In the morning, we will talk through the issues with our small communities to get a better understanding of what the issues are that they've identified. In the afternoon, we are putting together a series of resource panels, and we will have breakout groups we will have all five of those topics represented, but there will only be four breakout groups, and so you get to go to four out of your top five. Sorry about that. Although we're kind of trying to figure out how to make all five available. And then we are also putting together a resource notebook, so when you leave here, you will have information. We will be opening online registration in the next couple of weeks. I will be working with Steve Erickson and his team to make online registration available to you. We want to make sure that our smallest communities get first dibs. We don't mean this to be an exclusive club here, but we want to make sure that our small communities get heard and listened to and have their needs addressed. So on a space available basis, we will open it to the rest of the membership as well, because the information will be valuable, but we want to make sure that the small communities get a place at the table first. We are going to encourage our board members to attend. Please invite your mayors if you are not the mayor, and you may want to think about strategically which staff members you want to bring from your communities as well, because there will be valuable information for your town manager, your community development director, your planning director, those types of folks. So that is September the 15th. It will be a day-long event starting, we'll have coffee and donuts at 8, we'll start at 8:30. We will have a wrap-up at 4:30 and try and get you out the door before 5. So I would be happy to take any questions.
Any questions for Flo? Director Sullivan.
Sorry, start with a comment, and thank you to DRCOG for sponsoring this from Lyons, Colorado. Being a small community, I completely agree with the top five priorities. Infrastructure projects are next to impossible on a $1 million general fund budget. Especially when you have CDOT, you know, highway to Rocky Mountain National Park kind of going directly through your town. So I really appreciate the attention to this issue. Just a question on the date. The invitation that was sent around to our team was August 18th. So I just wanted to see, is that a different workshop, or has the date changed?
Oh, was that to save the date?
What date did you think it was?
Oh, is that the election?
You know what? That's the Department of Local Affairs.
Oh, my apologies.
Small Communities Forum.
Okay,
in Brighton.
I'm getting them confused.
And yes, and we did send out that information to you as well, because that's going to be a great event as well, and it dovetails really nicely with what we will be presenting in September.
Okay.
So
perfect. More attention on small communities, the better. Thank you.
Yes.
Good to know. Other comments, questions? All right, thanks, Flo, for doing that. It's exciting stuff. All right, next up, we have our Bike to Work recap. And how about those great T-shirts?
Those are awesome T-shirts, aren't they? Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, directors of the DRCOG board. My name is Steve Erickson, and I am the Communications and Marketing Director here at DRCOG. Part of my responsibility is to oversee management of the Way to Go program. And the Way to Go program is all about reducing traffic congestion and improving air quality in the region. So we promote things like carpooling and vanpooling and taking transit and even working from home. But along with that, of course, we're promoting walking and biking as healthy choices. So the biggest event we do each year related to biking is, of course, the Regional Bike to Work Day event. So I want to give you just a quick overview of what we'll talk about. just kind of a who, what, when, where, why of what this event really consists of. I want to give you some specifics related to the 2016 event, which was very successful. And then I want to make sure we kind of tie this back into the long-term benefits to the region and really talk about what is such a healthy ecosystem in terms of biking in our region right now, and then just talk about next steps. So to get started, Dr. Cog has been organizing this event for almost 30 years in the region. We use, by the way, federal funding. CMAQ is congestion mitigation and air quality funding. We use those funds both for the Way to Go program overall and specifically for the Bike to Work Day event as well. As you might guess, we also solicit a fair number of sponsorships from corporate folks throughout the region. Some of that does come in the form of cash. Most of it now is kind of coming in kind. We get a lot of donated advertising from people like Nine News, and Bill, thank RTD for your help with getting signs on the buses and the light rail. The idea with this event is to create a really supportive, fun, and safe environment, and to encourage people to try bicycle commuting for the first time. We are number two. Chair Jones asked me downstairs a little bit ago, are we still number two? And I kind of put my head down and said, yeah, we're still number two. We are the second largest event of this kind in the country. If you're curious, we're chasing San Francisco or the Bay Area. And I will say that they haven't reported numbers in the last few years, but the last time they did, it was somewhere in the neighborhood of 40,000 riders, and I'll get to our metrics here in just a few minutes. But the event is always the fourth Wednesday of June. That's by Colorado statute. You may or may not know that most of the rest of the country celebrates Bike to Work Day in May. I think our legislature wisely considered weather conditions, particularly in some of our mountain communities, and decided May might not be the best time. So Colorado has June as Bike to Work Month, and that fourth Wednesday, which this year fell on June 22nd, is Bike to Work Day. The idea with this is if you get all these people to try biking in this fun and supportive environment, that they'll continue to bike to work at least some of the time going forward, and we've been really successful with that. So people realize, again, it's easier than they thought, and the benefits are significant in terms of your health, and it's good for the region, and it saves you some bucks, so it's all good. Here you'll see a picture of Lieutenant Governor Lynn and some handsome guy on the right, unidentified. Anyway, so the numbers for this year. Let's look at the numbers. We had 32,000 riders estimated. 37% of those, I'm really happy with this number, 37% of those were first-timers. So in a single day, we were able to introduce 12,000 people to bicycle commuting. The average commute distance was 9.2 miles one way, so about 18 miles round trip, for a total of 589,000 miles traveled that day by bike by our participants. The next two numbers, it's really kind of, I want to recognize my Way to Go staff. I mean, this is a huge and heavy lift every year, and I have a relatively small staff. I think the only person on my staff who is here is Amber Lieberman in the back, but we do a great deal of work for this one-day event. This year we had 260 stations. Those are breakfast stations. Those are bike home stations, which primarily have water, and also quite a few bike home parties this year. In addition to that, 779 businesses participated in our business challenge. So we go out to businesses throughout the area. And I should mention, the Way to Go organization is really a partnership between Dr. Cog, and we work with seven transportation management associations in the region. So we don't do it completely alone. We have a lot of community partners, and we work with people in most of your communities. But that 779 businesses go out and compete in kind of a friendly competition, and we have an effort index to kind of reward those that have done the best work. The reason I put the picture in here with miles is that the Denver Broncos were one of our sponsors with the breakfast station for the first time this year. Over at, I don't know if we still call this Sports Authority Field or not, but over at the stadium.
Mile High.
So one of the cool things we did this year is we contacted Strava, and I don't know if you are aware of who Strava is, but they make a mobile phone app. A lot of athletes use this app for training.
I'm on it.
Mr. Cernanik is on it. And we contacted them a couple of months ahead of Bike to Work Day, and we asked them if we might have access to Bike to Work Day data, those that were taking trips on the morning of Bike to Work Day, and specifically from 5 a.m. to 10 a.m. That's sort of our busiest time, and they agreed to do that in return for some recognition and some sponsorship. So the first visualization that we made from that data is this heat map, which is a representation of where people were riding on Bike to Work Day. It's a little bit hard to see the darker blue lines, but that's sort of you know, where we had fewer people. When you get up to the real thick, almost white lines there, those were the busiest paths that folks were on. So not surprisingly, you see quite a bit of activity up in Boulder on the south end. That's really the South Platte River Trail and the Cherry Creek Trail. I was really pleased to see the amount of activity along the new US 36 Bikeway. You'll see a really bright white line kind of along that particular pathway. This next one, I'm going to cross my fingers that this will work for us. And again, I want to say I work with some really, really talented people. Justin Martinez is actually one of our economists on staff here, but he created this interactive map. Apparently he does some coding, but what you're looking at here is sort of travel between different zones, and we had to make some arbitrary decisions about what these zones might be. But as an example here, when I mouse over this, you'll see Northwest Denver. If you see that hump like that, that's just within the region. People biked to work within that region. But as you can see, if I move over here to some of these other areas, this tells me, I'll try to get this on one, this would tell me the number of people that biked from the Northwest Denver region to the one that we called Northwest Metro, and you can kind of see the yellow area on that map. So these are available from the Bike to Work Day website. It's just kind of interesting for us to be able to look at this, and I think in the future, you know, we've kind of learned a lot, and we'll have additional visualizations to kind of help tell our Bike to Work Day story.
And can you give us what that website is, please?
Yes, it's just biketoworkday.us, and there should be a link from that site about halfway down on the left, I think. Close out of that. So one of the other really big highlights from Bike to Work Day this year was the opening of the bike library in Golden. And this is notable for a number of reasons. Firstly, this was a DRCOG-funded project. So in addition to the partnership funds from CMAQ, we also have pool project funds. So the city of Golden would have applied for the pool project for this bike library a couple of years ago and been allocated those funds this last year. And on Bike to Work Day, June 22nd this year, they opened this bike library. It's a little different model than what you'd find with B-Cycle. I think they recognized they wanted a variety of different kinds of bikes and even sizes. It's very family-oriented. And so you'll see Mayor Marjorie Sloan cutting the ribbon there. And again, we were just very pleased to see that open on Bike to Work Day. The other highlight, my staff would tell you, is that we didn't have any floods in the afternoon this year. So I'm not putting pictures here. We were so concerned that there would be this hangover effect from the epic floods of last year, but it was really just a nearly perfect day. Beyond Bike to Work Day, again, our focus in the Way to Go program is about long-term change. We're trying to affect behavior change in this region. And it really all ties back into the Metro Vision goals of reducing vehicle miles traveled per capita and reducing the percent of single-occupant vehicle travel. DRCOG, I think, has led the way, as I said, for almost 30 years. But I just want to point out we're just a part of a really healthy ecosystem in this region. So if you think of the number of organizations that are involved in promoting biking, from B-Cycle to Bike Denver to Bicycle Colorado to Community Cycles up in Boulder, and you think of all the different events, there are so many different events now. Matter of fact, leading up to Bike to Work Day, City and County of Denver has Bike to Work Wednesdays for about a month and a half, and we support that with our My Way to Go platform. Lots and lots of those events. And so for us, it's, you know, I think we've been a really important part of that, but we're certainly not doing this alone. We're riding in tandem with all of you. So how are we doing? Just some quick facts. Between 2000 and 2014, bike commuters in this region doubled. So the number of people that are commuting by bike has doubled in those 14 years. On a typical day, about 20,000 people are biking to work in the region. I think, you know, that's, I think Steve Cook would tell me, sort of a yearly average kind of a number. So on a beautiful sunny day, it might be more like 40,000 people. Colorado now is the number three state in terms of bike commuting in the nation. Does anybody have a guess as to who's number one? Oregon. Yep. And this is sort of looking forward, and this comes from the DRCOG model. By 2040, we're projecting that all trips, kind of person trips in the region, are going to increase by 35%. Biking is going to increase, or expected to increase, by 56%. So again, I think we're doing really well. And we're just about done. I think one of the things we talk about, again, with Bike to Work Day, to put it into sort of big picture perspective, is all of the support that is shown for biking in the region, demonstrated by folks participating in all these events, I think really helps us as we go and look for even funding for biking infrastructure. So just a quick snapshot, there's roughly 2,300 miles of bicycle facilities in our region. This board, I think, pays attention. The last tip cycle, what was approved was 21.4% of all projects, of the project dollars, were for bike and pedestrian projects. So I think we're getting it. And I think a lot of your communities are doing some great things, too, with putting in protective bike lanes and things like that. So just a lot of regional momentum. So we'll wrap this up. I just wanted to show you a few more images that kind of give you a sense of the day. It was a really great day, I think. For us, next steps are we'll do a follow-up survey in about 2 months, and we will determine how many of the people that participated are kind of continuing to bike on a regular basis and saying they'll continue to bike moving forward. Those 779 businesses that participated, my outreach staff and the outreach staff at those TMAs that I talked about that work in your areas, we'll be contacting every one of those businesses and introducing them to other commute choices. So we'll be promoting carpooling and vanpooling and all of those things as well. And again, I want to thank each and every one of you that helped with Bike to Work Day. I think we sent out about 30 t-shirts. Many of you were involved on the day of. I think I ran into, not physically ran into, I saw three or four of you on Bike to Work Day. And it was, again, I think just overall a really great event. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thanks, Steve. That's exciting. We should all feel very proud of that success, particularly the staff that worked so hard to make it happen. Questions, comments? All right. Good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So heading down the home stretch here, committee reports. I'll start off with the State Transportation Advisory Committee, from what I can remember before I went on vacation. The state released its economic forecast on what it expects from Senate Bill 228 funds, and they projected $110 million transfer in 2017-18, which allows CDOT to budget for that, which I think is of interest to us. There's a whole lot happening with freight right now. There's identification of critical rural and urban freight corridors that we need to pay attention to, because you have to be part of the network in order to qualify for the new freight funding. So that's being worked on. And the work's beginning on the multimodal freight plan and state freight and passenger rail plan, which is a bunch of different plans all mushed together related to freight and integrated, not mushed together. The technical term. And I was added to the Alternative Fuels Committee, so anybody wants to talk to me about that, we'll be more active on that front. I think those were the highlights. I think I'll leave it at that. Director Acheson, you want to tell us about the Metro Mayors?
Metro Mayors has formulated its transportation committee. They've started the meeting. We'll have some documents out to that board at the September meeting for them to start to look at as a first draft. But as far as the caucus itself, they did not meet in the month of July. They'll meet in August. And Madam Chair, with your permission, I'd like to divert before we all get up and run out of here. If in the event that any of you have been blinded by a certain amount of light in the room tonight, I get a chance. Yeah, Jennifer, I'm going to pick on you. Jennifer Castle is one of the lobbyists that works for us here at DRCOG as part of the Tomlinson Associates, and we are missing a member of our board tonight because I learned earlier that he is home making the last minute plans of their wedding in 10 days.
Aww.
Congratulations, Jennifer. Oh, yeah. Would you like to announce who the board member is?
Oh, I'm sorry. That'd be Commissioner Tim
Mock. And I'm hoping because he's marrying you, he'll show up to DRCOG meetings on a regular basis after that, right?
Thank you, Matt.
Congratulations. In terms of the metro area county commissioners, we take the summer off from meetings, so no report there. Director Shenanick, you want to talk about the AAA?
Real quick, there was no meeting in July. However, some folks might want to pay attention to 1470 at 4 o'clock on Saturdays. It is where our interviews occur. And recently, someone that many folks in the room know was interviewed and will be in a forthcoming segment of No Copay Radio. So nocopayradio.com, 1470 on Saturdays at 4 o'clock.
Excellent. Shakti wasn't able to attend the last Regional Air Quality Council meeting, so she asked me to report. As you all probably remember, the Denver metro region is out of attainment with a 2008 ozone standard, and we were downgraded to moderate status, and so that required us to develop a state implementation plan. So we had a special meeting in June to sort of a culmination of over 6 months of pretty intensive work to unanimously approve the SIP and forward it on to the Air Quality Council. It'll probably get tweaks during the Air Quality Council process. We anticipate it will, but it reflects a whole lot of work, and I think we're patting ourselves on the back to get that out the door, and then we can immediately start working on trying to come into compliance with the new ozone standard, which will be an even tougher one. The Air Quality Council will be holding its hearing in late October, so there's still an opportunity for people to be involved in that process. Air Quality Control Commission, I'm sorry. So that's what the RAC's been up to. And Director Rakowski, E470.
Meeting was canceled, but there is some good news from E470 that Commissioner Partridge and I would like to share, which is you may have noticed the new temporary license plates. They're starting to be required, and this will have a positive financial impact on the counties that where people sometimes in the past with the old paper plates would wait 3 to 4 years before they would get around to actually getting real plates. E470 alone loses $11 million a year in temp plates that couldn't be read. So this is a technological step forward, which CDOT was part of, a whole bunch of people, but it's a good thing so that the scofflaws among us will no longer be able to ride on the backs of the rest of us.
Thank you. All right, Bill Van Meter.
Thank you, Chair. The RTD Fast Tracks Monitoring Committee met on July 5th. Some of you may recall in May at this meeting of the Board of Directors of DRCOG, I previewed an upcoming report. We made that report to our board at this Fast Tracks Monitoring Committee meeting. The intent of the report was to analyze the four unfunded corridors and fast tracks and ascertain whether any of them might be eligible for federal funding through the New Starts or Small Starts federal funding scenarios. So the question that was being asked and that my staff and I looked at was whether any of the four unfunded projects on fast tracks would be eligible for federal funding under the current rules for federal funding, which is a competitive process. We presented that information, the results of that analysis, to our board on July 5th. wasn't a fun time for me or my staff, because the answer is, at this point, no. There are two sets of criteria that the federal government looks at. It was a long, detailed technical presentation that we went through with our board of directors. I won't bore you. But the two high-level criteria are, one, fiscal capacity. And frankly, right now, RTD does not have the fiscal capacity to be able to match federal funds to complete those corridors, as well as project justification, which looks at criteria such as ridership, cost-effectiveness, land use, environmental impacts, land use impacts, those sorts of justification measures, impact measures. And the projects did not fare very well in those measures either. Those rules change over time. We also reminded our board that both the North Metro and I-225, our line projects through Aurora, were funded without federal dollars. So we aren't giving up. We continue to look at alternatives and options, but that's where our analysis landed. I previewed that with this board with you in May, and I wanted to report those results, which were presented to our board. The other item that we discussed was the first segment of the Northwest Rail Line, the B line, and the grand opening, which is all on track, Mayor or Director Atchison. There you go. And so just a brief update on that. The grand opening will take place next Monday, July 25th, at the Westminster Station at 10 a.m. That's when the grand opening ceremony will occur. That day, rides on just the B line will be free. The following Saturday, that's the 30th, Saturday, July 30th, there's going to be a celebration at Union Station from 2 till 6 p.m. and at Westminster Station, sponsored and supported by Westminster, from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. So the fireworks can go. So if you missed July 4th or didn't get enough, Westminster is sponsoring and putting on a 9 o'clock p.m. fireworks show on the 30th. All of our rail lines will be free that day. So we're adding extra capacity and looking forward to that event. That concludes my report.
Thank you. And Director Rakowski,
With RTD in conjunction with us, the event on the 30th is a completely free event. There's a carnival with 25-cent booth type things, a lot of carnival activities. But to Bill's point, we are putting another 4th of July fireworks show on that night down at the station. So free parking in the garage. Come on down and go for a ride.
Director Rakowski.
And on a personnel note for RTD, as to the board, a longtime member, former member of this board, Doug Tisdale, has basically will be elected in November because there's no competition. So Doug is coming back.
How exciting. All right. Well, let me close this meeting by saying you all did such a great job tonight. We won't have a work session on August 3rd. So pat yourselves on the back for that. Director Shenanick.
Just a question about having no work session on August 3rd. The performance group usually meets after the work session. Herb, are we having a meeting on August 3rd?
Yes, you are.
Okay.
Sorry.
Well, that, for those of us who aren't on that committee, well, we'll think of you. So everybody got that? No work session, but the committee will meet. All right. Thank you all very much for a great meeting.